children, welcome to our science session. In this session we'll continue our science chapter. Hello children, welcome back. In this science session we will continue our chapter Microorganisms, Friend and Foe. Till now in this session we have learnt about what are microorganisms, different types of microorganisms, uses of microorganisms, harmful effects of microbes or microorganisms. In harmful effects of microbes or microorganisms, we have learnt about diseases caused by microorganisms in human beings, animals and plants. And in last session we have learnt about spoilage of food, that is how food is being spoiled by microorganisms, and that leads to food poisoning. To prevent this, how can we preserve food, that is preservation of food by various methods, that is harmful microorganisms, they causes diseases in plants and animals. So those disease causing microorganisms are called as pathogens, and some microorganisms they grow in food substances and they produce toxic substances, toxic or poisonous substances, which makes the food poisonous. And this food poisoning leads to illness and even death. And as well as some microorganisms spoil materials like clothes, leather, wood, etc. And as these disease causing microorganisms, what we call that as pathogens, they spread diseases from an infected person to a healthy person. So such diseases are called as communicable diseases. Example, we have learned cholera, common cold, chicken pox, tuberculosis, etc. And some insects and animals also act as a carriers of disease causing microbes. These microorganisms are being carried away by different means, transmitted by different means, what we call them as carriers. Example, housefly, female Anopheles mosquito, female Aedes mosquito, they carry these microbes, pathogens, and they transmit from the infected person to a healthy person. So these organisms are called as carriers. And in last session we have learnt about food poisoning could be due to the consumption of food spoilt by some microorganisms. Microorganisms that grow on our food, they produce toxic substances which makes the food poisonous. And if we eat this spoiled food, it leads to serious illness and even death. So it is very important to preserve food to prevent it from being spoiled by microorganisms. So the food which is being preserved by preserved in order to protect them from being spoiled by microorganism, what we call that as food preservation. And food preservation, that is if food is being spoiled by microorganism, we have learned that it has bad smell, bad taste and causes food poisoning by seeing only, by smelling and by changing the, by seeing the color change, we come to know the food is being spoiled. So food can be preserved by protecting it from microorganisms. So we have learned food can be preserved by different methods, namely chemical method. In this chemical method, like food like pickles can be preserved by using chemicals like salt and edible oil. So jams and squashes can be preserved by using sodium metabisulfite and sodium benzoate. These chemicals are called as preservatives. So chemical preservatives, you can name that as edible so common salt, edible oil, sodium. These two are used to preserve pickles, and sodium benzoate and sodium metabisulfite is used to, or chemicals used to preserve jams and squashes. Next, we have learned that by using common salt, food items like fish, meat, raw mangoes, gooseberry, that is amla, tamarind, they can be preserved by using common salt, and it prevents the growth of microbes. The same way, by using sugar, food items like jam, jelly, squashes can be preserved by using sugar in the form of crystals or in the form of sugar solution. It can be, or in the form of honey. Various ways we can use this sugar in order to prevent the growth of microbes. Then next, we have learned about by using oil and vinegar. Food items like pickles, vegetables, fish, meat, etc., they are preserved by oil and vinegar. Vinegar is nothing but acid, acetic acid. It prevents the growth of microbes. And this oil, how can it prevent the growth of microorganisms? So if it forms a superficial layer on these food items and prevent the entry of microorganisms, thus by using oil and vinegar, the growth of microorganisms can be arrested. And next, we have learned about by heat and cold treatment, heating of food items oftenly, which kills the microbes or disease causing microorganisms. Similarly, storing food items like low temperature, that is in the refrigerator, etc., prevents the growth of microbes. And next, we have learned about pasteurization. The process of heating milk about 70 degrees Celsius for 15 to 30 seconds and then suddenly cooling it to prevent the growth of microbes is called as pasteurization. It is a process in which milk is heated up to 70 degrees Celsius for 15 to 30 seconds and then cooling it suddenly or chilling it suddenly to prevent the growth of microbes is called as pasteurization. And this process was discovered by Louis Pasteur. And next method, we have learned about by storage and packaging. Many items, they are stored in airtight container, vacuum packaging, and to, or it may be in a closed sealed container in order to protect them from microbes. So in this way, we have learned different ways to protect food or to preserve food in order to protect them from getting affected by microorganisms. And now in this session, now we have come to the end of the lesson. That is, now we will be learning about nitrogen fixation. That is, we have already learned in standard 7, this bacterium, rhizobium bacteria, which is involved in the fixation of nitrogen, isn't it? And this rhizobium bacteria, they are present in the root nodules of leguminous plants, pulses like beans, peas, etc. In these roots nodules, you can see that in the figure, knot-like structure, that is called as root nodules. In those root nodules, this rhizobium bacteria, they live and they help in nitrogen fixation. And they show here symbiotic relationship. What do you mean by symbiosis or symbiotic relationship? Both the organism, they are benefited by each other. Here, this leguminous plants also benefited by rhizobium bacteria, and rhizobium bacteria is also benefited by the leguminous plant. How this plants, they cannot utilize nitrogen directly from the atmosphere. So this rhizobium bacteria, they help in converting atmospheric nitrogen into nitrogen compounds and fix it in the soil. From there, this rhizobium bacteria utilize nitrogen for their growth. And in the same way, this leguminous plant, they provide place, shelter for this rhizobium bacteria to live in their root nodules. So in this way, both the organisms here, the leguminous plant as well as this bacteria, is benefited by each other. So this, what we call that as symbiotic relationship, isn't it? And other than this nitrogen fixation by bacteria, sometimes this nitrogen gets fixed through the action of lightning. and anyhow, whatever it may be, whether the nitrogen, atmospheric nitrogen being converted into nitrogen compound by bacteria or by lightning, but the amount of nitrogen present in the atmosphere remains more or less constant. You may wonder how it happens, because continuously atmospheric nitrogen is being utilized, then also this amount of nitrogen present in the atmosphere remains more or less constant. That is 78% of atmosphere nitrogen is present in the atmosphere. And so two natural nitrogen fixing bacteria are there. That is nitrogen fixation by bacteria. One is cyanobacteria. See, you can see here blue green algae, and the other one is, see that at the top, that is rhizobium bacteria. Here in this picture on the screen, what you can see is the first one at the top is rhizobium bacteria, and down, that is green like this, called what is that? Cyanobacteria, otherwise called as blue green algae. So name two bacteria which are helpful in nitrogen fixation. It is natural way of nitrogen fixation by bacteria, called as rhizobium bacteria as well as cyanobacteria, or you can write as blue green algae. And see, you can see here various roots of leguminous plants are shown here. You can see that knot-like structure, what we call that as root nodules. In these root nodules, this rhizobium bacteria is present. You can see here some roots of cowpea plant and beans, etc. So in these are all leguminous plant. In these leguminous plants of roots of these plants, nodules are there. See, knot-like structure in these nodules, root nodules, rhizobium bacteria is present. So now let us learn about nitrogen cycle. Naturally, this how you in lower classes you have learned about water cycle, that cyclic nature of water being this, so that water can be utilized again and again. The same way, nitrogen, because of nitrogen cycle, naturally this nitrogen content present in the atmosphere remains more or less constant. So now let us learn about nitrogen cycle. We know that our atmosphere has 78% of nitrogen gas. And what is the use of this nitrogen? Nitrogen is one of the essential constituent of all living organisms. See, in our body, this nitrogen plays an essential constituent of all organisms. Like as a part of proteins, in plants you can call this in part of chlorophyll, nucleic acids and vitamins. Nucleic acids like DNA, and vitamins. So in this way, nitrogen is one of the essential constituent of all living organisms. Got it? So how nitrogen plays an important role in our life? Nitrogen, it forms an essential constituent of all organisms as a part of proteins, chlorophyll, nucleic acids and vitamins. Now this nitrogen, atmospheric nitrogen, cannot be directly taken, utilized by plants as well as animals. So certain bacteria and blue-green algae, which is present in the soil, they fix the atmospheric nitrogen and convert it into compounds of nitrogen. And once the nitrogen is converted to usable nitrogenous compounds, then it can be utilized by plants from the soil through their roots, isn't it? And nitrogen then is used by the plants for the synthesis of plant proteins and other compounds. Then once if plants produces plant proteins and get stored in them, then that will be eaten by animals. So animals, those feeding on those plants, also get these proteins and other nitrogen compounds. So in this way, plants and animals get the atmospheric nitrogen with the help of rhizobium bacteria and blue-green algae. And this when after once if it enters into the plant's body, that is from the plants which is fed by animals also get those proteins in nitrogen in the form of proteins and get stored in their body. And once when plants and animals die, the bacteria and fungi which are present in the soil, it convert that nitrogenous waste into nitrogen compounds, and again that can be used by the plants. So certain other bacteria, they convert some part of nitrogen part of this nitrogenous waste into nitrogen gas, which goes back into atmosphere. As a result, the percentage of atmosphere remains more or less constant. Got children, from the atmosphere, with the help of rhizobium bacteria or blue green algae, it convert the atmospheric nitrogen into nitrogenous compounds and fix it in the soil. So from the soil, plant utilizes this nitrogen and in the form of proteins, chlorophylls, nucleic acids, etc. And then when these plants are fed by animals, and some part of this proteins enter or in the nitrogen enter into animals' body too. When these plants and animals die, they get buried into the soil. In the soil, you can see that bacteria and fungi present in the soil. They convert the nitrogenous waste, whatever gets stored in the dead bodies of plants and animals. Again, they get converted into nitrogenous compounds, and again, it will be present in the soil. Again, either it will be used by plants for their growth, or some bacteria which converts this denitrifying bacteria, what we call that as denitrifying bacteria, they convert this nitrogenous waste into nitrogen gas. Again, nitrogen gas will enter into the atmosphere. So in this way, the amount of nitrogen present in the atmosphere is more or less constant. Now we'll see here in the cyclic manner with the pictorial form. See, you can see that nitrogen present in the atmosphere at the top, and this nitrogen present in the atmosphere is being fixed by bacteria, certain bacteria which are present in the root nodules of leguminous plant, and then from there the plant absorbs, or the nitrogen, some microorganisms which are, that is blue green algae, or we call that as cyanobacteria, which are present in the soil, it convert that atmospheric nitrogen into nitrogenous compound in the soil. So nitrogen is being fixed by two ways, one certain rhizobium bacteria or by cyanobacteria, and then from the soil plant utilizes for it, isn't it? Then after plants and animals die, by denitrifying bacteria, they convert the nitrogenous waste into nitrogen compounds and fix it in the soil. Again, it is being utilized by plants. And some other fungus and bacteria which convert this nitrogenous waste into nitrogen gas, and directly it released into the atmosphere. Got children? See one more here, the cyclic manner here, atmospheric nitrogen. See in your left hand side, you can see first at the top atmospheric nitrogen, then your left hand side first box by atmospheric nitrogen is being fixed by nitrogen fixing bacteria, isn't it? Then bacteria, it fixes nitrogen into nitrogenous compounds, then nitrogenous compounds present in the soil, it is utilized by plants, then plants are eaten by animals. Then after this, plants and animals die, the nitrogenous waste, as well as from excretion, as well as after they die or by their excretory waste product, again they get converted into nitrogenous compounds by certain other bacteria. And here in your right hand side, you can see bacteria turn this nitrogenous compound waste into nitrogen gas, and nitrogen gas again being released into the atmosphere. So in this way, the nitrogen is being cycled, and that is the reason why atmospheric nitrogen amount of atmospheric nitrogen remains constant, more or less constant. And so again, your various steps as again nitrogen fixation. As a recap, we can see atmospheric nitrogen is converted by lightning or by certain bacteria like rhizobium, acetobacter or cyanobacteria or blue-green algae which are present in the soil into nitrogenous compounds. And then this compounds, conversion of this compounds into nitrites and nitrates, this process what we call that as nitrification. Then plants utilize this nitrogenous compounds from the soil to synthesize proteins and other compounds, what we call that as assimilation. Then animals feeding on plants also get these proteins and nitrogen compounds. Then when plants and animals die, the bacteria and fungi present in the soil, it convert nitrogenous waste into nitrogenous compounds that can be used by plant again. And some nitrates being converted into nitrogen gas, which is released back into the atmosphere by certain bacteria. So this process, what we call that as denitrification. Hence, atmospheric nitrogen remains constant. Our children, we have completed this chapter, and that's all for this session.